performance.
Way to swing your bat, kid!
Get ready to learn a lesson from McGuire, Griffey, Ripken, and more. Major League Baseball is proud to introduce Hitters on Hitting, Finding the Sweet Spot. Some of baseball's all-time heaviest hitters reveal the inside secrets of their swing with exclusive interviews and footage not available anywhere else. The interactive DVD includes over 50 minutes of bonus material that USA Today calls pure perfection. Hitters on Hitting is available now wherever videos and DVDs are sold.
The Oakland A's began the year as champions of baseball and had confidence that the 1990 season would bring them more of the same. Tony La Russa's task would be to keep the A's from growing complacent, from resting on past laurels. The Bash Brothers certainly didn't, as Jose Canseco hit 37 home runs in 1990. Mark McGuire would become the first man in history to hit 30 or more homers in his first four full Major League seasons. Also getting high marks, Rickey Henderson, the ultimate catalyst. Rickey hit a career-high 325 in 1990 and passed Ty Cobb to become the American League's stolen base leader. From Bob Welch, the A's also got a career year with a major league leading 27 wins. Dave Stewart won 20 for the fourth year in a row, and as a bonus, got his first career no-hitter. Even when things went sour for the A's, like the loss of Dave Henderson, the team responded by acquiring veterans Harold Baines and Willie McGee. Oakland won its division, then left Boston in its wake in the championship series, sweeping the Sox in four straight. The A's did not grow complacent. What they did was win their third consecutive pennant, something just 21 teams have managed to do in the history of baseball. The 1990 Oakland A's primed for the World Series like never before. In Cincinnati, Reds owner Marge Schott hired Lou Piniella to turn a team of promise unfulfilled into one that would make a little noise in the National League West. The optimism was contagious.
If we start out and win our first 30, 35 games in a row, we're going to be in first place.
I agree.
The thing is, they were serious, winning their first nine games in 23 of their first 30. The Reds as a team were as nasty as their bullpen, which was led by Rob Dibble's 1.74 earned run average. And the stopper, Randy Myers, who had 31 nasty saves in 66 games. It was obvious these Reds were a throwback to the old days. They were feisty and fired up and wouldn't take no for an answer. They were in first place from day one. And during a rain delay in late September, they got what they deserved. Nothing could dampen this moment for the Reds. They had won the West in style. It was on to the playoffs against the Pittsburgh Pirates, and it was in game two that Paul O'Neill got them going, driving in both runs in a 2-1 victory that evened the series at one game apiece. O'Neill also cut down the potential tying run in the sixth.
There's the catch, and the runner moves on to third base, and he's out!
The venue shifted to Pittsburgh for game three, and the power shifted to the Mighty Mites of Cincinnati, led by Mariano Duncan, who had a homer and four RBIs in the Reds' 6-3 triumph. In game four, it was Chris Sabo who carried the offense, With a two-run home run and three RBIs, he led the Reds to a 5-3 win as the Pirates took a walk on the losing side. Defense, once again, made news for the Reds, with the headliner this time, Eric Davis.
O'Neill is going to go for third with one out. He is out!
The Pirates won Game 5, but in Game 6, Luis Quiñones got a clutch pinch hit in the seventh inning to give the Reds a 2-1 lead. All that remained was still another defensive gem, this one by Glenn Braggs, and some nasty boy relief from Randy Myers, and the Cincinnati Reds were the National League champions. The first time they could make that claim since 1976. They'd be underdogs in the series, but they were cocky and confident with nothing to lose. The 1990 World Series between the Oakland A's and the Cincinnati Reds opened in Cincinnati, Ohio, where the focus was on the defending world champions with their mighty bats and their big-name stars. The only ones paying attention to the Reds were the A's themselves, especially their studious manager, who was already looking for whatever edge he could find. It was time to make new friendships and rekindle old ones. And it was time for one starting pitcher to offer some advice to the other. But Jose Rio already had all the advice he'd need, thanks to former pitcher Juan Marichal, who also happens to be Rio's father-in-law. Marichal forged a Hall of Fame career with the Giants, with six 20-win seasons in the 60s, and that extra high kick that made him a menacing figure on the mound. These days, Juan is a scout for Oakland, and indirectly, a matchmaker.
My father was working for the Oakland A's. Well, he still is, and my mother and I, we went to pick him up where he worked at this baseball field, and I met Rio, but it was so funny because I didn't even meet him. They didn't even introduce us to each other, but we saw each other. And then that's the way. And then that night I saw him at the stadium. He's like, hi, gorgeous. And that's the way, you know, that we met.
2 years later, they were married. And while Juan got a grandchild out of the deal, Jose ended up with a pretty good pitching coach.
My father, he was a great pitcher, and he gives them a lot of advice, especially on concentration. And Rio, he sticks, you know, he goes by his words, and he's done great.
Sometimes he lose the concentration, like that home run against Green. I think that was lack of concentration. But
I agree.
They really have something really special going, because it's, you know, it's more than just like a father-in-law. He's like a father to him. Like the father that Rio never had, my dad is like his father.
But now Juan faces a dilemma. His son-in-law is scheduled to be the starting pitcher in Game 1 of the World Series against the team that gives Juan his paycheck. So for whom does he root?
I want him to do a good job, but I want Oakland to win.
Somewhere deep inside, I know he has to be pulling, or at least wishing, that Rio does his job. You know, not that he's gonna just root for the A's, but my father does have to be pulling for Rio to do his job and come out looking, you know, good.
Game time, and the family parts along company lines. We already know for whom Rosie is rooting. Meantime, up in the booth, next door to the CBS voices of Jack Buck and Tim McCarver, Juan prepares for his Spanish language broadcast. And on the field, Jose takes that oh-so-lonely place.
Let's go, Rio!
On the mound. His mission? Keep the A's off the bases.
Ricky Henderson, you know how he is capable of starting a game with a bang.
Say, come on, Daddy, let's get him.
Rosie fully understands the importance of a good start.
Yeah, come on.
And that setting the tone against Henderson would go a long way toward establishing Riho's confidence.
You're out. That's the way this one starts.
Come on, Riho, two more.
Following the second out, Riho has his first confrontation with the other Jose.
Two on another high fastball and moved him back.
That's the scouting report on Canseco. Hammer hard inside.
Come on, Riho. Don't lose him. Yeah! Yeah!
Yeah! Riho was the picture of concentration in the first, but in the bottom half, his counterpart, Dave Stewart, seemed to lose his. And uncharacteristically walked Billy Hatcher. With two out and one on, Eric Davis found himself in a World Series dream and sent a wake-up call to his teammates.
When I stepped up to the plate and I looked out there and I saw Dave Stewart, I knew it was for real. I wasn't jittery or anything like that, but it was just a real special moment to know that I was there. And Stewart had been getting behind on the first couple hitters. He really didn't have his control, and I knew he didn't want to get behind on me. I said I was going to swing at the first strike that I felt I could handle, so I was just trying to make good solid contact and hit it wherever it was pitched.
Fly ball to deep, deep center field. McGee back. It's going to go. Why, you would think they just won the World Series.
That was big for us, not only psychological, but emotional, because having a World Series in Cincinnati for the first time since 76, and people doubting us the way they have all year, and being able to get out in front on a pitcher of Dave Stewart caliber, it lifted everybody's spirits up, especially being at home. It took a little steam out of them, and it brought our crowd right back into the game. And, we just started to rally around that, but I don't think that you can say that really got us going. And it showed that we can win because we always believed that we can win. And the guys just went up there and they just swung the bats.
But the Reds were far from finished. In the bottom of the third, with Barry Larkin on first, Oakland made the first of what would be seven straight mistakes against the wrong guy, Billy Hatcher.
What an ungoing. And that ball is fair. And the run will score. The runner goes to third. He's safe there.
Then a Paul O'Neill RBI, and the Reds were up by four. As the game moved into the fourth inning, Jose settled into a groove. Sometimes he reached back for a little extra speed. You know you've got good stuff when the other guys start talking to themselves. And sometimes Riho reached back for something else.
Broken bat. Oh, look at that. Behind the knee. Hey, that's pretty cool, isn't it?
Did you see what Riho did, Mommy?
Riho Rojo Caliente.
Yes, Riho was red hot. The A's were anything but. It looked to start running to get warm in the fifth.
There goes Henderson. And a base hit by McGee. Ricky goes on to third. Runner going. Ball 3-0, throw a stolen base for McGee. Now it's 3-2 to Canseco. And a base hit would mean a couple. They have a base open. McGuire next. And Cronella chomps on the chewing gum.
Oh my God.
Outside, he walked in. That is the second walk by Riho, both given to Canseco. And the bases are loaded, two out, and the tying run comes to the plate. And
the batter will be Mark McGuire. He could tie it up in a blink. And now, Oakland has left seven. And after four and a half, they still trail 4-0.
And Rosie gets a knowing glance from Mom, who's been there before with Juan. But as the game moves into the seventh, Jose appears in complete control.
Three more easy ones. Come on.
So it's one on, one out in the seventh inning. And the batter, Willie McGee. That might be a double play. They got one. Yep. 4-6-3. That's all in the Oakland seventh, and they still trail 7-0.
Rijo's work is now complete. Seven innings pitched, no runs, five strikeouts, and a quiet appreciation for his efforts from Rosie. And yes, there was even a member of the A's who was proud of Rijo's efforts.
You can see that his fastball was moving. He was very fast. And he got a few guys out with the fastball that I don't think they expect that kind of fastball from him. But he was throwing the ball real hard and in a good location.
Rob Dibble set down the A's in the eighth. And in the ninth, Randy Myers. On to close out the first game victory by a team many predicted wouldn't win a game.
And McGee hits it to O'Neill. The Reds have won it.
The man of the hour, Jose Rijo, who won over a lot of skeptics with the triumph and maybe even made a dent in his toughest critic.
Even when I pitch good or bad, still not good enough for her. She said, oh, you do this, you know, you make one mistake, you did that, you know. And I said, Rosie, why don't you, you know, trying to pitch sometimes and see how tough it is. He said, I wish I could pitch for you. But again, you know, just wife, you know, they want you to do everything, you know, this perfect way.
It ends as it began, with a hug and a kiss, and a reaffirmation that family is and always will be more important than baseball.
I think it's a very nice and a beautiful thing, you know, when you are doing, you know, working, you still can be with your family.
But as good as it felt to the Rijos and the Marischals, the win felt even better to the Cincinnati family.
We came in here not to be an opponent. We came in here to win a World Series. You know, our ball club was in first place from day one to the end of the season. We played under a lot of scrutiny. We had to play big games all year, and I think that was a very good tightener for us. So now you win game one against a team that is supposed to be invincible. We took it to them. We dominated the game, and that's a big confidence booster.
Word was out on the street. Yes, the underdog Reds could compete. Having slain the Giant in game one, Cincinnati was talking a different game now as game two approached.
You guys getting all this?
There was the confidence, the swagger that winning a game can bring. And as the A's said a silent prayer that Jose Canseco's back and bat would loosen up, the Reds as a team were very loose indeed. The Cincinnati fans were also feeling their oats as they welcomed the first lady to throw out the first ball. But if Barbara Bush thought she was getting off the field with just a kiss for the catcher, well, they don't call him Sweet Lou for nothing. And on that note, La Russa, too, proved to be a sweetheart. No question, everyone was feeling pretty good as game time approached, especially the A's, who had Bob Welch set to go. The 27-game winner would be facing a man who was injured much of the season in Danny Jackson. Like any other pitcher, Jackson understood the need to neutralize the bat of Henderson, perhaps the game's all-time leadoff hitter. But sometimes even that doesn't work.
And a base hit by Ricky Henderson. He shattered the bat, but starts the game with a bang, a base hit for Henderson.
And that could spell trouble for Cincinnati.
You see, when Ricky gets on base, Ricky likes to run.
There he goes. And no chance, and a stolen base for Henderson.
The Ricky rally was on, and La Russa, intent on getting that first run, uncharacteristically had Connie Lansford bunt. With Henderson now on third, Cincinnati had to contain Canseco, and for the most part succeeded.
And a ground ball to Morris. He boots it, the run scores, and out at first, and an RBI for Canseco, and Oakland jumps on top 1-0.
But as the game moved into the home half of the first, the A's found a Reds team anxious to get back into the swing of things. And that meant swinging at almost anything.
Fastball hit into right field into the corner. Canseco can't get there. That's a ground rule double. And Canseco did not see that ball.
On came Billy Hatcher, coming off a virtuoso 3-for-3 performance in game one, looking for his fourth straight hit and the chance to drive in a run.
And that ball will advance the runner and tie the game. And Hatcher gets two, and he's thinking about three now as Canseco fell down and now back to second base. We're tied 1-1.
Hatcher eventually made it to third on a flyout by Paul O'Neill. And game one hero Eric Davis needed only to make contact to give the Reds the lead. The score remained the same into the third inning, but then Jackson's action on his fastball began to tail a bit. And when that happens, you don't want this man standing at the plate.
2-0. Into the opposite field, and that ball might tie the game, and it does. Canseco made it look easy, and it's 2-2.
Bass brother number one had awoken, and Bass brother number two followed with a single. Two walks later, the bases were loaded with one out.
And a fly ball for Eric Davis, and the runner tags. And the throw home is wide of the mark, and the A's take the lead 3-2.
Mike Gallego then offered his contribution.
Gallego drills one into center to add to the lead. His first hit of the series, and it's 4-2. And if they let Bob Welch get any further out in front, well, this one is going to be over early.
That was all for Jackson and the A's. And in the fourth, the Reds retaliated.
I wish they'd give us something to yell out here.
It began with catcher Joe Oliver, who took a Welch offering and hit it where it was pitched. With two men out, the wheels began to turn. Ron Oster was called on to pinch hit for Scott Scudder.
And he hits it up the middle. Now we're going to have a play at the plate. Dave Henderson throws. He is safe. The Reds get a run. Oster down to second with two out.
So with the Reds now within one at 4-3, they called on, no, not one of the Nasty Boys, the exact opposite.
Talk about a piece of Americana. Here is Jack Armstrong pitching with the American flag on his chest. How about that?
All-American boy.
And this All-American boy, pitching in the Fall Classic, stifled the A's with three strong innings. The only bashing Oakland was doing was in the dugout. As the eighth inning commenced, the stage was set for a World Series milestone. In his last six at-bats, Billy Hatcher had banged out six hits. One more, and he owned a new record.
You get in a group where you get a lot of hits, you get a lot of chink hits and everything, but right now, I mean, it seems like everything I swing at, I'm hitting the ball very hard. I'm getting a good part of the bat on the ball right now, and your confidence level is up, and you know, I go up to the plate right now saying, I'm gonna get another hit, and it's working out for me so far.
Billy Hatcher leads off. He's trying to set a record here. Hatcher flies to righty field, and Canseco cannot. It's off his glove. Hatcher's going to end up at third with nobody out. Tying run. Tim, you can't tell me that Jose Canseco is at full speed health-wise. He hasn't made any plays out there
today. No, that's exactly right. Back problems bothering Canseco. Remarkable athlete. Normally, he makes that play.
See, he can't even stop and turn around and chase the ball.
Right. The seventh consecutive hit for Billy Hatcher.
After O'Neill walked to put runners on first and third with nobody out, the Reds elected to play it a little too safe.
Fly ball will tie the game. The runner tags at first also. Oh, they stopped him. Hatcher stopped, and that's the first out of the inning. I thought that was very conservative coaching, Tim.
Absolutely, and I think Lou Piniella did, too. And you can see his disenchantment with Sam Palazzo, the third base coach, and R. Hatcher.
La Russa tried to capitalize by bringing in Rick Honeycutt, a left-hander, hoping he could get a ground ball double play from pinch hitter Glenn Braggs, a right-hander. And the strategy almost worked to perfection.
And a ball up the middle, and will they get a double play? No, and we are tied. Hagel needed a perfect bounce and didn't get it.
Well, he got a true bounce, but he was too far on the other side of second base. He can't stop his momentum to come back and tag second. He has to tag the sliding O'Neill, and by the time he recovers, Braggs slides into first. Brother.
Here we go. 4-4. What a game. You can't get any better than this.
The tension was unbearable as the game moved into the ninth, and the Reds called on Dibble to hold the fort. And hold the fort he did. Meantime, in Cincinnati's half of the ninth, fans throughout the ballpark tried their hand at prophecy.
Pretty well hit. Henderson adds it to out. What a great play by Ricky Henderson.
Getting the remarkable instincts of Ricky Henderson. This ball hit hard, not a lot of hang time. Henderson has to get back and react.
Whoa, look at that thing in the
snow cone.
Snow cone.
Snow cone, watch.
And he says hello to the wall.
On it went into the 10th, and things looked bleak for Cincinnati. For the A's had brought on the ultimate stopper in Dennis Eckersley. And in the riverfront stands, some hearts began to melt.
Oh, come on, Dennis! Be good to us! Be good to us!
The Reds countered with a fresh-faced rookie, and those melting hearts in the stands asked the obvious question.
Who is it swinging the bat?
Billy Bates.
Bates? What's he put him in there for? Where's Quinones? I don't know about that move, Fanella.
Well, I can't use Quiñones in that situation. First of all, there's one out. There's nobody on. Quiñones' forte is yes, coming off the bench, but I like to save him for opportunities when he can drive in runs. That plus the fact that he's not the speediest guy. So I use Bates. If he gets on, now I can steal with him, get him in scoring position. And then finally he chopped the ball off a home plate and he was off and running.
And a high chopper, and this will be close. It's a base hit for Bates.
Even the skeptics like that move. And they liked it even more when Chris Sabol lined a single to left. And so the man who caught the first pitch would also hit the last one.
And the batter is Joe Oliver. He made the last out in the eighth inning and left two on. That ball is fair! Cincinnati's ahead! Two games to none!
With the Reds now up two games to nothing, Oliver had the dream of a lifetime to cherish for a lifetime.
When I first hit it, I thought it might go foul, but I was fortunate enough that it stayed fair, you know, not by much at all. But I think as I got about a third of the way down, I saw that the third base umpire called it fair, and all I could do was just throw my arms up in excitement, and I was glad that my family was there to be a part of it. And it was really nice. My father was there, and of course my wife, and I have a 7-week-old son and in-laws, and it seemed like I had everybody in town. And it was a big thrill for myself and my family.
Family was a hot topic at the end of game two. Meet Tucker Thomas Browning, who began asking to be born around the seventh inning of game two, thereby creating this dilemma. Does one leave a World Series game to watch his son get born if he might be needed later to pitch?
I'm sitting in the dugout in about the seventh inning. One of the clubhouse guys, Rick Stell, came up to me and said, Tom, your wife's downstairs. She needs someone to move a car.
Well, I delivered the message, but I didn't know she was in labor. The only thing I got was that his wife needed to see him.
And I panicked. I didn't know what to think. I said, oh, no.
And his eyes got bigger than light bulbs. I mean, he was like...
In fact, Ronnie Osa was going to go with me. I said, no, I'll be right back.
He went out to the parking lot, and then he found out. And so he just left right away, uniform and all.
And never in the world did it ever occur to me that I might have to pitch that night.
We were running out of pitchers. I think we had two left. And so he wanted Tom to start warming up. And they come in to get him. One of the trainers in to get him. And Tom wasn't there.
I saw Lou on TV. I mean, just furious, screaming. And I thought he was mad at a player, not knowing it was me because I wasn't there. And he didn't know where I was at.
So we called up Marty and Joe's booth, Marty Brown and Joe Nuxall's booth. And we told them if they could relay the message to somewhere to tell them that, Tom, we need you back. We need you back to the field. They need you to pitch.
And so I put it on the air, and I'm thinking to myself, this is Wednesday night, and he's supposed to pitch on Friday. And I can't imagine that Lou would want him back in the ballpark to pitch.
So, Tom, if you're listening to the broadcast, we've just gotten a word that from the Reds clubhouse that if at all possible, please get back to the ballpark in the event that they might need you.
It was as bizarre a thing as I've ever been a part of. As it turned out, he never heard it.
Tom wasn't listening to the radio. He was listening to television, and that was the first time he heard it from me when I announced it in bizarre fashion on the air.
We just learned that Tom Browning earlier left the ballpark. His wife went into labor. The Reds clubhouse called up to Marty Brenneman, asking Marty to make a public announcement and tell Tom Browning to return to the ballpark.
I tell you, I've heard of a lot of things happen in a baseball game, but I've never heard of that.
When I heard that, I got up and I was pacing the floor, and she was 15, 20, 25 minutes away from giving birth, and I couldn't leave, and I wasn't going to leave. There was just no way. I was just hoping that whoever was pitching would either hold the lead or somebody hit a home run and we win the ballgame before, at least until after the baby was born. And fortunately, we won the ballgame. But there was a great night, I'll tell you. It was a long night, but it was a great night. I really enjoyed it. And Well, to go 2-0 up on the A's in the World Series was great, and then a half hour later being able to witness your third child come into the world, and it was great.
And so the World Series shifted to Oakland, a city as famous for its waterways as it is for its freeways. And if the world is at home here, the World Series certainly is, having passed this way for the third straight year. A's fans were optimistic about returning home. But the pregame of Game 3 also served as a reminder. Some of these players weren't here in 89, but from those who were, they've come to know how very hard it was to carry on. For it was just before Game 3 in 1989 that the Bay Area and baseball endured an earthquake, one that left everybody in awe of its power. And while Oakland looks fine on the outside, a closer look reveals that some effects remain. There is still much work to be done, but it's happening slowly and surely. And be certain that the pride these folks have in the A's success is a big part of that resurrection.
Last year, the World Series was real important to Oakland. Amid all the destruction and devastation, people could focus on the A's and the World Series, and it kept people's spirits up. That's what kept us going, I think, to some extent. This year, it's more of the same. Oakland, of course, has come back quite a bit. There's new construction. A lot of the damaged buildings have been repaired. But the A's just keep winning and keep selling out, and it just keeps the community spirit real high.
And as the A's took the field for Game 3, that sense of pride and community was never higher.
Ladies and gentlemen, we ask you to please rise as the Oakland Athletics and Major League Baseball would like to take a moment to remember the Bay Area citizens who were victims of last October's Loma Prieta earthquake prior to Game 3 of the World Series. Thank you.
To throw out the ceremonial first pitch, a man who was very instrumental in helping Oakland recover from the aftershocks of last year's quake, A's pitcher and number one humanitarian, Dave Stewart. You could see the A's were loose, but not quite as loose as Cincinnati, a team with no intention of going back to Riverfront. Of course, nobody was looser than the proud new Papa as Browning prepared to make his first ever World Series start. In contrast, A's starter Mike Moore started two World Series games in 89 and won both of them. But this time around, he dug himself a second inning hole thanks to Sabo.
Third baseman Chris Sabo.
Well hit ball by Sabo, carrying to the track to the wall, and Cincinnati leads it 1-0. Sabo cracks one over the fence.
The A's were down once again, but not their fans.
Season is yet to be over. Come on, let's go A's!
A Dave Henderson double in the bottom of the second inning played perfectly into Oakland's hands, for this was an American League park, and now these teams were playing American League baseball.
Harold Baines, the designated hitter, is up. Wow, did he hit that one? Wow! Adios, and Oakland leads it 2-1.
Lou Piniella gave every indication that the Reds would also be aggressive in the third. And even though Larkin popped out leading off, pitching to the next man was merely a formality.
Here's Billy Hatcher. They finally got him out. He hit into a double play in the first. He's 7 out of 8. He starts another streak. Billy Hatcher starts another streak, a one-out single.
Then with a 3-1 count on O'Neill, Cincinnati decided to force the issue.
3-1. Runner going. And off the glove of McGuire. Hatcher scoots on to third, first and third with one out.
La Russa was staring in the face of a big inning, and Moore looked to try and strike out Davis with a little high heat.
Shot to center. That ball drops. We're tied, and O'Neill heads for third. The throw by Dave Anderson. Offline, and Davis down to second.
What was joy for one section of the stands was an unfolding tragedy for another. And though it looked like Oakland might escape when the second out was made by Morris, there was much, much more to come.
Come on, Mike, let's get out of it, huh? One down's not so bad. Here we go.
He corks another to left field, sending Ricky Henderson back, but not far enough. Another home run for Sabo, and it is 5-2. A two-out home run makes it 5-2.
Sabo wasn't about to get overconfident. Not against the A's.
They're too good of a team, and, you know, I follow along. They had the capabilities of coming back in the game. I was telling everyone on the bench to keep going and keep working hard because, you know, they have such great players. I knew they can come back.
But the inning was far from over.
Duncan, a ball up the middle, and another run. And it's 7-2.
He was out! He was out! Oh, man! Oh, come on! Seven runs in one half an inning.
And ironically, the man who made the final out was Hatcher.
Finally.
Yes, the third out, yes!
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Okay, let's get seven runs back now.
Nice to dream anyway, but unfortunately Browning was in a ground ball groove. He threw so many, in fact, that it enabled Sabo to tie Pinky Higgins' one-game World Series record for third baseman as he handled 10 chances without an error. The sabotaging continued.
And what a fine play by Sabo. He gets the out. That was terrific. Sabo, fielding flawlessly at third, gets his man. There's Sabo again. He hasn't done anything wrong tonight, and he's done a lot right.
The only question that remained for Oakland fans was to watch, or maybe not watch, as Randy Myers came on to put them in a 3-0 hole.
Tough night for the A's. I thought the home setting would bring them back.
Somber and stunned.
And that's the way this one ends, and Cincinnati leads it 3-0. What a job they are doing on the Oakland team.
They're just getting us out and stopping us from getting the big inning. I mean, they're pitching well, and they're hitting very well, and they're playing. I mean, they're doing everything that that they want to do right now, you know, and we're not.
We still have that faith and that confidence in our club and in between each other, and we feel that we can do it. We just got to try to go out there and try to create things, make something happen, hope that we get some of the breaks that's going around. You know, when Pittsburgh said that Cincinnati had all the breaks, I didn't believe them, but I see they have a lot of breaks going. So that's what happened. Must be their year or something, huh? Somebody ain't told us yet.
Far from desperate, the Reds had their eye on the improbable. Who would have thought that after 3, they'd be on the brink of whisking the A's away in 4? La Russa had some house cleaning of his own to contend with, and had made for some radical changes in his lineup. All-star catcher Terry Steinbach and all-world outfielder Jose Canseco were benched for this, the most crucial game of the year. In their stead, Willie McGee would play in right, and journeyman catcher Jamie Quirk would bat ahead of McGuire. Oakland obviously needed inspiration and sought it from former A's outfielder Joe Rudy, who was called on to throw out the first pitch and put a little 1972 into the 1990 A's. Jose Rio didn't have to look back quite so far for inspiration. He just wanted to regain his rhythm from game one. With a power shortage in their lineup, the A's looked to Stewart as their savior. But while Oakland's ranks had been depleted before the game began, it was during the game that Cincinnati would have two key players go down for the count, with Billy Hatcher the first to fall. It would be Hatcher's last at-bat in the series, leaving him with a 750 average, breaking a four-game record held by Babe Ruth for 62 years. Hatcher temporarily stayed in the game, though the Reds didn't score in the inning. Then in the bottom of the first, another Red fell by the wayside.
Come in. He had the ball in his glove. Had he held on, that's a legal catch, but it looked like he turned over on his hand. Could have been his right knee. That's also been giving him problems.
He's holding his back.
Davis also stayed in the game, and with McGee having gone to second on the play, the Reds elected to walk Harold Baines and take their chances with Carney Lansford. Lansford had just three hits in the series to this point, and this would be a fine time for another.
And up the middle, and Oakland takes the lead. And Baines stops at second base, and it's 1-0 Oakland.
The Athletics 2-for-23 before that hit, with runners in scoring position.
But while the A's got to celebrate some early success, the Reds were left to focus on the future. Hatcher was out, his hand required x-rays. Davis, too, was hospital-bound with what later would be diagnosed as internal organ injuries. One of the playoffs' defensive heroes was called on to fill the void left by Davis.
Eric Davis. Number 15, Glenn Bragg.
Come on, baby, let's go.
And you might say Bragg's was pumped.
Is going on
I
here.
I've never seen that before. He swung and missed and broke the bat.
Now look at this. It hits his back and breaks in two.
Bragg's never did get a hit, but the Reds almost put together a mini rally against Stewart with two outs in the second. It began as Chris Sabo did his best to keep pace with Hatcher.
Sabo, his seventh hit of this series, coming with two out, the first Cincinnati hit.
But then to the Reds' chagrin, what was once good news, La Russa's move to bench Canseco, paid defensive dividends for the A's.
Fly ball to deep right center by Benzinger. McGee is on the move, and he caught it. What a play by Willie McGee. I tell you one thing right now, Canseco would not have caught that ball.
But while the Reds didn't score, they didn't fall any further behind either, thanks once again to Riho, who ignored the plaintive cry of Oakland fans.
Riho, you're dead tonight!
We'll be right back. Unfortunately for Cincinnati, Stewart was matching Rio pitch for pitch until he faced Larkin in the sixth.
That's ball four. Puts the tying run out.
A lot of options for Lou Piniella now. You can hit and run, you can allow Larkin to steal, or you can bunt.
Herm Winningham was Hatcher's replacement.
There goes the runner. Winningham dunks a hit. There goes Larkin to third. Throw is not made as Henderson dropped the ball. First and third and nobody out for Cincinnati.
After O'Neill popped out to shortstop, it was up to Braggs to try and tie the game.
Left fielder, Glenn Braggs.
Come on, get Braggs out.
Opportunity knocks for the Reds right here. High ball three. If this were the Cincinnati situation, were they in the field now, that bullpen would be buzzing. Piniella knows that this is a grand opportunity for him, perhaps end this World Series tonight. First and third, one out. He was taking, that's ball four. That's the second walk of the inning in the game, and the bases are loaded and one out.
The onus was now on a man who up to now had one hit in the series. Designated hitter, Hal Morris.
Larkin at third, Winningham at second, and Braggs at first with one out.
That double play ball.
Maybe a double play, out at second. The A's still lead. The A's still lead 1-0.
The A's had survived once again, but you can only ask so much of your ace, and as Oakland carried its tenuous 1-0 lead into the eighth, you could sense a change in its fortunes. All year long, so much had gone right, and in less than a week, so much had gone wrong. And now the visitors prepared for the kill.
Hit for Larkin. And this is four innings in a row that Cincinnati's put the leadoff man on base.
With Winningham now at the plate, the obvious play was a bunt. But once he had worked an 0-2 count, there was nobody in the park who thought he'd still be bunting. The more likely consensus was to try a straight steal.
I'd send him.
He bunts, and the play will have to be to first and safe. Winningham beats it out, a two-strike bunt.
How about that?
He was in a perfect spot.
You couldn't have put a blueprint down any better than Winningham, and Jamie Quirk, understandably, coming out slowly to field it, and Winningham has a bunt base hit with a count 0-2.
This strange quirk of strategy left La Russa dumbfounded. And Lou figured that if it worked with this light hitter, why not try it with Paul O'Neill, one of his power hitters?
And that bunt will cause the play to go to first and safe in the possibility. Stewart pulled Randolph off the base, and La Russa wants to come out and talk about that one. Base is loaded, nobody out. Well, that's a big play, and it really opens the gates. Argument is ended.
Willie Randolph tries to stay on the bag as long as he can.
Base is now loaded, nobody out, and Glenn Braggs in a situation that Eric Davis lives for.
Hits a possible double play ball, and only one, and a run scores, and we're tied.
With the score now tied at one, La Russa decides not to go with Eckersley, entrusting the game to his starter. And with runners now on third and first, the opportunity exists for Morris to have a memorable series after all.
We scored this run, we are in the car.
Double play!
Game's over. We score this run, the game is ours.
And a high fly ball to right will put Cincinnati on top. The runner tags, they could never throw him out. The throw goes into second base, and it's 2-1 Cincinnati. Yeah! Winningham, who had that bunt single, scores the go-ahead run.
The A's were a team defeated. Their proverbial balloon had burst. And having retired 19 in a row, Rio opened the ninth against a miracle man from the postseason past with a message that this year there would be no such miracles.
Strike, and the Reds are two outs away from being the champions of baseball. That's 20 in a row for Jose Rijo.
It was then that Pinella elected to bring in Randy Myers. And La Russa countered with the highest paid pinch hitter in the world. It left Lou open to lots of second guessing and set up a classic situation.
Rijo out. Canseco coming up.
Power versus power.
Chopper to Sabo. Two out. Canseco fails to deliver. And the Cincinnati bench ready to explode.
The unimaginable was at hand for the Reds. A four-game sweep of Oakland.
Up into short right, foul ball. Bensinger wants it. Cincinnati, the champions of baseball for 1990 with an improbable sweep over Oakland.
There was nothing nasty about this moment whatsoever. Two generations of pitchers, now linked by family, shared the tears of victory. And a team that no one really gave a chance against mighty Oakland rejoiced, led by Rijo, the series MVP.
I felt confident all along. When we clinched our division, I knew that we were going to play very well in postseason play because we got the monkeys off our back. Remember, this club hadn't won in a while. And once you taste that winning feeling, that confidence really exudes. And once we beat the Pirates, I knew we'd be ready to play here against Oakland.
The reception in Cincinnati was even better than they dreamed. But then the Reds had given so much more than the fans had ever asked.
I remember being out here in 1975 and 1976. We won it then. We're going to bring it back again next year.
As it turns out, in Cincinnati, sweep dreams really do come true.